So I'm going to read a little section in which Debbie, at 12 years of age, is going to a company picnic. At Plutonium Park, the picnic was in full swing. Mom went off to the tent where the women were dropping off their cakes and casseroles and jello salads. Linda and I bought a string of tickets for carousel rides at a card table set up in front of the cenotaph, a huge black granite bomb with Cadillac fins hung in mid-plummet on invisible steel wires. Behind it stood an older stone statue of a soldier fainting into the arms of an angel. "To our glorious dead," read the faded inscription beneath the soldier's boots, followed by a list of Shipman's Corners men who had laid down their lives in two world wars. The angel and the soldier were overshadowed by the big stone bomb. Its plaque read, "To our radiant dead, in honor of the gallant machine operators of Shipco Corporation, who answered the call of industry to build nuclear arms for peace. May the almighty manager grant them eternal rest." Linda and I walked away from the carousel, past a pink gazebo reserved for a troop of snuggle girls, costumed as cheerleaders, French maids, and Shetland ponies. Employed by Shipco, the girls were always on duty during family picnics, in case any of the managing executives required tension relief. Mom had repeatedly warned us not to stare at the snuggle girls, but I glanced in anyway. They were lounging around a table, smoking and playing cards. In a tent not far away, Mom and the other mothers were setting out platters of hot dogs and buns like rows of babies swaddled in puffy white blankets. By some unspoken agreement, the Shipco snuggle girls ignored the Shipco wives, and vice versa, even though they were always stationed side by side at the company picnics. Linda stopped outside the mother's tent and glanced casually back at the carousel where a carny was lifting kids onto horses. "Why don't you run along and find your friends?" she suggested. I walked to the playground where the Donato twins were playing fallout shelter under the high slide. Judy Garland Donato waved an aluminum pistol in the air. "Let's pretend to shoot people who try to get into our shelter," she suggested. "Why not just let them in?" I asked. Judy Garland Donato snorted. "You dummy, you'd run out of food. You have to look out for number one." I was still arguing with the twins over whose turn it was to have the gun for our game of shoot the neighbors when a policeman and a nurse walked up. I couldn't tell you what they looked like. All I saw were two uniforms. "Miss Debbie Biondi?" asked the nurse with a bright smile. She was wearing a white dress, white stockings, white Oxford shoes, and a stiff white hat with little meringue wings. I raised my hand. "That's me." "Come with us, miss," said a tall, skinny body in a blue uniform that smelled sharply of solvents, as if it had just been dry cleaned. The policeman wore a silver badge reading "Officer Smith, number ABC123. He took my right hand. The nurse took my left. I had a wild idea that I should twist out of the grown-up's hands and start running, but I shook it out of my head. I was a good girl with a missing father, heading off with two unknown authority figures. What could possibly happen? "Did they find my dad?" I asked as we walked away from the playground. "Still looking," said the policeman in a monotone. "What's your favorite ice cream?" asked the nurse, a smile in her voice. I looked up at her. "Butterscotch." "Well, honey, you're in luck. Where we're going, there's a whole tub full of scutterbotch with your name on it." We reached the brick building that housed the park snack bar, shut tight for the season. As the policeman unlocked the door, I stared at the giant cardboard strawberry ice cream cone stuck to the outside. We went into a room with lumpy white walls, then through it into another room with a gray metal door and no windows. Rakes and shovels hung from hooks along the wall. Once the door to the second room was closed, I couldn't hear anything from outside, not even the music from the carousel. The lights in the room were twilight dim. The nurse sat me down in a straight-backed wooden armchair next to a table with a box on it, wires hanging down. The box was bright pink with blue polka dots and glowed palely in the gloom. The top of the box was full of knobs and dials like a shortwave radio or the cockpit of a jet. "What's that thing?" I wasn't scared yet, but it was starting to dawn on me it should be. "Have you ever heard of a polygraph, honey?" asked the nurse. I shook my head. "A lie detector," said the policeman. "This here's a special one, just for kids, so we know which of you are naughty and which are nice." He laughed at his own joke. The nurse glared at him. "It's a machine that shows us if you're telling the truth," explained the nurse. "How's it do that?" I eyed the machine with growing fear. "It picks up signals from your body. It shows us if you're getting all tensed up and scared the way people do when they're lying," said the nurse. "See that graph there? It jumps when you get scared. That's when it knows you're lying." "Don't tell her how to beat it," growled the policeman. "I'm not. I'm simply explaining to the child," said the nurse. They slid my arm into a sleeve. The nurse pumped a little rubber ball attached to it, and the sleeve went tight. She stuck wires on the tips of two of my fingers, then pulled a strap tight around my chest. The nurse said that Pat Boone had a lie detector, just like this one, in his own home to keep his kids honest. Every time they did something bad and he thought they were lying, he hooked them right up to the machine to sort things out. "Who's Pat Boone?" I asked. "He's a world-famous operatic tenor. Kids these days," the nurse said, sighing, as if only a juvenile delinquent wouldn't know who Pat Boone was. "Stall for time," I told myself. "That's what captive girls always did in comic books while waiting for a superhero to show up." I said, "The strap around my chest is too tight. It hurts." The nurse laughed her phony laugh again. "Don't worry. You'll get used to it.